Cartoonito Tales, Little Red Riding Hood. Adam has spent the morning baking peanut butter cookies with his grandma. They are made with her secret recipe. The cookies have been cooling down for quite some time. Adam is sure they must be ready to eat by now. He carefully lifts up the tea towel. The cookies look so good. "Me grandma won't mind if I try just the smallest one," thinks Adam. He slides the spatula underneath the smallest cookie. He wiggles it and waggles it, twists it and turns it, until the freshly baked cookie comes flying off. It lands on the floor and rolls straight down a mouse hole. Grandma doesn't like mice at all. She won't be happy when she finds out they have one of her cookies. Adam reaches into the mouse hole to find it. As he does, something very curious happens. The little mouse hole begins to grow bigger and bigger, until there is just enough room for Adam to crawl through to the other side. Who would have thought such a beautiful forest could be hidden just behind Grandma's skirting board? The long grass tickles Adam's ankles, and the tall trees make him stretch to see their tops. What a wonderful place this is! A little girl with a red cape skips through the forest. She stops to smell the flowers. Then she skips right into Adam. "Hello, I'm Little Red Riding Hood," she says.
"Hello," says Adam. "What have you got in your basket?"
She lifts up the lid to show Adam the cookies inside.
"They're for my grandma. She lives just down the lane," she says.
"Those cookies smell so yummy. Please, can I have one?" asks Adam.
"My grandma is ill in bed." "No, she needs these cookies to make her feel better," says Little Red Riding Hood.
A naughty wolf creeps up behind them. Adam and Little Red Riding Hood are very scared, but the wolf just laughs.
"Don't be afraid," she says. "I'm a friendly wolf."
Adam and Little Red Riding Hood don't know if she's telling the truth. They've never heard of a friendly wolf before.
"Cookies," says the wolf as she peers into Little Red Riding Hood's basket.
"They're for my grandma. She's ill in bed,"
says Little Red Riding Hood. The wolf smiles a toothy smile.
"I really must be getting to grandma's," says Little Red Riding Hood.
She skips off along the path. Adam quickly follows. He doesn't want to be left alone with a wolf.
"I wouldn't go that way if I were you," says the wolf. "There's a big bad wolf who eats little boys and girls for breakfast waiting just behind one of those trees."
"Oh no! However will they get to grandma's?"
"Never fear," says the wolf. "This path might take longer, but it's very safe."
Adam and Little Red Riding Hood thank the wolf for her kindness. Then they skip down the nice, safe path. But they should know better than to trust a wolf. She smiles a sly smile and runs all the way to Grandma's house. Adam and Little Red Riding Hood finally arrive at Grandma's. It took a very long time, but at least there were no wolves along the way. Little Red Riding Hood knocks on the door.
"Come in,"
says the strange voice. Doesn't sound like Grandma at all. Little Red Riding Hood peers down at Grandma tucked into bed. She looks an awful lot like a wolf in a nightgown and cap.
But Grandma, what big eyes you have, says Little Red Riding Hood.
All the better to see you with, my dear, says the wolf.
But Grandma, what big ears you have, says Little Red Riding Hood.
Why, all the better to hear you with, my pretty, smiles the wolf.
But Grandma, what big teeth you have, says Little Red Riding Hood.
All the better to eat you with, says the wolf.
She opens up wide, ready to gobble up poor Little Red Riding Hood. But Adam empties the basket of cookies straight into her mouth.
The wolf licks her lips. These cookies are so yummy. I will never eat a little girl ever again, she says.
Hooray! Adam and Little Red Riding Hood cheer. But what's all that noise? Someone is trapped inside Grandma's cupboard. Adam and Little Red Riding Hood open the doors, and inside is poor Grandma. She is so happy to see Little Red Riding Hood, she gives her a very big hug.
Ja bring my cookies? She asks. I'm sorry, says the wolf. I ate them all.
Grandma is very cross. Cookies always help her feel better when she's sick.
You natty wolf, she says, shaking her walking stick. I'll chase you out of my house and into the forest where you belong.
Adam and Little Red Riding Hood have to stop her.
But Grandma, the wolf said she was sorry. Please, can she stay?
Says Little Red Riding Hood.
I promise never to eat little girls ever again, says the wolf. Cookies taste much better.
Grandma is very happy to hear this indeed. Little Red Riding Hood teaches the wolf how to bake her special cookies. Adam and Grandma weigh the butter. They carefully measure out the sugar. Then they weigh just the right amount of flour. The wolf stirs it all together. And last of all, Little Red Riding Hood adds the very special ingredient. Sticky, gooey, peanut butter. Soon the mixture is nice and thick. The wolf spoons it onto the baking tray into nice round cookie shapes. Grandma puts on her oven gloves and carefully slides the tray into the oven. Grandma dances a special dance to make the cookies taste extra special. Everyone joins in. Then they play a clapping game while they wait for the cookies to finish baking. The oven pings. The cookies are ready. Grandma carefully takes them out of the oven. They take one each and tuck in. The cookies are delicious. In fact, they're almost as good as Little Red Riding Hood's. Soon it's time for Adam to go home. he waves goodbye to his new friends before crawling through the mouse hole. Adam is home safe and sound. But his grandma will be very cross when she finds out one of her cookies is missing.
Look, there's a magic cookie jar on the table. Adam opens it up and inside there are two cookies.
Grandma will be very pleased the mice didn't get to eat any after all.
Cartoonito Tales, A Trip to the Moon. Daisy and George are making their very own spaceship out of a big cardboard box, shiny tinfoil and brightly coloured bottle tops. They would love more than anything to fly all the way to the moon. Then they could find out what lives up there. Daisy thinks moon cows live on the moon. And George thinks extra special moon plants grow on the moon. They take it in turns to look at the moon through their telescope. But they can't see any moon cows. And they can't see any moon plants. It's just too far away. Perhaps if we wish very, very hard, then we might one day be able to go to the moon, says Daisy. They get into their spaceship. They close their eyes and wish very, very hard. Suddenly, a bottle top pops off the spaceship. Daisy and George open their eyes just in time to see it bounce, bounce, bounce across the room. It lands straight down a little mouse hole. George reaches inside to find it, and as he does, something very curious happens. The little mouse hole begins to grow bigger and bigger until there is just enough room for Daisy and George to crawl through to the other side. Hidden just behind the skirting board of their very ordinary house is the most extraordinary spaceship. Daisy and George are so excited. They grab the space helmets from their hooks and put them on. What a magnificent view Daisy and George have from up here. The Earth looks very tiny from so high up in the sky. But look, the moon is close by. George takes control of the spaceship and pilots towards the moon. But he doesn't know how to land. He presses all the buttons. A red light starts to flash. Daisy holds on tight as the spaceship rattles and shakes. Then, with a bump and a bang, they crash land on the moon. Daisy and George climb out of the spaceship. They are so proud to be the very first boy and the very first girl to have ever landed on the moon. George shuts the spaceship door safely behind them. At first, the moon seems a little cold and a little grey. But as the sun rises, the cold grey moon comes to life. Moon plants shoot up from the soil. And tasty-looking moon fruits grow from their branches.
I was right, says George.
And look, here comes a herd of moon cows.
We were both right, says Daisy.
If plants and animals can live on the moon, there must be air to breathe. So they take off their space helmets. Daisy and George stroke the moon cow's fluffy fur, and sparkly moon dust floats off into the air. They even try the moon fruit. Tastes just like cheddar cheese. But little do they know the Selenites are watching them, and they look very cross indeed. They creep out of their hiding places and chase Daisy and George round and round the moon. Daisy runs as fast as she can. But the biggest Selenite runs even faster. She captures poor Daisy in her net. George runs and runs and runs, but he's too slow. The Selenite captures him in her net. Poor Daisy and George feel very frightened. The Selenites lock up Daisy and George in their jail. They will take it in turns to guard their prisoners day and night. Daisy and George feel very sad. If only they had stayed at home.
I do hope they don't want to eat us,
whispers George.
Don't worry, says Daisy. I have an idea.
She stretches out her fingers and reaches through the bars. Then she tickles the Selenite on guard.
She's very ticklish. She giggles and giggles, and then she drops the key.
George quickly grabs it and unlocks the door. Now they can make their escape. Daisy and George run to their spaceship as fast as they can. The Selenites chase after them with their nets. George tries with all his might to open the spaceship door. But it's jammed shut.
Quickly, George, says Daisy, before they get us.
But it's too late. They are surrounded by the Selenites. They raise their nets, ready to make their catch.
Wait, says Daisy. We're very sorry for eating your moon fruit. Please don't eat us.
We don't want to eat you. We're vegetarians,
chuckles the biggest Selenite.
We were cross because you took our moon fruit without asking.
Daisy and George are very sorry. They promise to always ask before taking anything that doesn't belong to them. They shake hands. The Selenites agree to let them go. But first, they must help with their chores. The Selenites pick the biggest moon fruits. These ones are ready to eat. George and Daisy help too. Then they cover the moon cows in magic moon dust. It keeps their coats nice and glossy. The Selenites milk the moon cow's pink udder.
Daisy and George can't help but giggle when orange milk comes out.
It ping, ping, pings into the silver bucket below. The moon is a very funny place. The Selenites invite Daisy and George to their party to thank them for all their help.
They eat tasty moon fruits and drink moon cow milk. It tastes just like orange juice. The Selenites even teach Daisy and George how to moonwalk. It looks like so much fun, they just have to join in. Soon it's time for Daisy and George to go home. But the spaceship door is still jammed shut. The Selenites sprinkle it with magic moon dust. It pings wide open. Now they can climb aboard. Daisy and George feel quite sad as they wave goodbye to their new friends. But they must get home, so they crawl through the little mouse hole. Their adventure to the moon was so much fun, but Daisy and George are glad to be back home on planet Earth. Every time they look up into the sky, they will think of the Selenites and the moon fruit and the moon cows. They look through their telescope way, way up at the moon. And what a sight they can see! The Selenites are waving at them!
You've been watching the Cartoonito YouTube channel. For more fun stuff like this, click the subscribe button.